I'm sorry to be the last one, but that's how we are sometimes. So when I first saw Cardo's, I had the impression that this would be an hour presentation. So you're going to get a very fast slideshow in 15 minutes. So I'll be skipping some sections, but I'll do my best to give you some information. Okay, so I'll give you some background on the Canadian Victory Guard. This has become now the Victory Guard project with IEEE. Smart Villages and Site. I'll go into background how we built our community to do this demo project. And community is a community of interest versus a community defined, as you defined it, based as a boundary in terms of people who live in that community. Some of the recommendations that we did and how we implemented the project. Okay, looks like we're losing some. Okay, so the Victory Guard, just for the benefit of those who don't know the concept, it goes back to the First World War. It was a British concept called Dig In. The Germans were actually had submarine technology at that time, and the Brits actually implemented a program of self-sufficiency. People grew food in their backyards, front yards, wherever they could. The same model was duplicated when the Americans came into the war in 1917, and Canadians were there fairly early in the game, as any other Commonwealth country. So the real focus of what we did is we looked at local food, no GMOs, no growth hormones, foods, and we tried to implement this model in our location, which is a 6-acre location in Canada. We built a greenhouse, and the location is completely off the grid. So it's a good demo site for replication in many parts of the world. Most of the world that are not connected to the grid will not be connected to the grid. The lines will go over their heads, but more than likely a lot of the individual small communities that we're trying to connect will need to have alternative energy. So what we did in this project with our community, meaning the university and ourselves, we dreamt up an idea of how to come up with an energy source which was focused on solar. We looked at how to capture heat from the ground and dissipate heat from the greenhouse with underground piping system and earth energy system. Came up with some ideas for irrigation system, lighting, and other things. And the last thing that we worked on is a mesh network. So this is a quick picture of what the greenhouse looks like. We have a small Raspberry Pi system in the greenhouse right now. Just to give you a concept of temperatures, it was 60 degrees Celsius recorded on the SD card the last day or so, and close to zero Celsius at night. So that was the swing of temperature. And for the benefit of Jane, who doesn't speak Celsius, it's 140 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay. So here's some pictures of some of the idea here in our greenhouse and our community garden program is to donate thousands of pounds of food to the local food banks. And we wanted to increase the efficiency of the greenhouse to increase food production. So our methodology of our community was working with the local university and our IEEE chapter. IEEE is the largest engineering society in the world, 460,000 members. You probably, in your own communities, you probably have chapters. Very important thing to connect with. And I handed out a brochure. I believe I was speaking to yourself that you're an IEEE site location, but you're all welcome to join it. There's some funding available for your startup for you if you're interested, but also you're connected to a really large source of experts that are focused on humanitarian technology. And it could be e-health, it could be alternative energy, it could be a range of things. What we did with universities, we sat down with the students and we wanted a brainstorming session. And these were all engineering students. And what was critical for them to is to speak the language of the end users, the people who are involved with running the guard. They are not technical people, so we wanted to have an ability or an opportunity for those who were engineering students to actually speak with the organizers. So again, I'm the technical coordinator of this project, but I've also been active in the humanitarian technology initiatives with IEEE, which goes back to 2009, where we partnered with the UN Foundation. And what we were trying to do is we were coming up with three mandates. One, alternative energy, a 1 kilowatt system, a reliable communication system, and the third one was patient records. And then the earthquake happened in Haiti, all the funds got funneled off. What we've done since then, we morphed off smart villages, and one of the first projects we did on alternative energy was in Haiti, contrary to the stuff that was being done by other organizations. And that was a very entrepreneurial model, and it's called a solar trailer system. And so I can give you details at another time. And the other aspect which is important in this is being partnered with the North Shore Amateur Radio, or AM Radio. So that gives another angle to what I'm going to talk about. Okay, so this is Joan is the executive director of the organization. We had other partners. Again, we facilitated with the students. I drew upon my contacts with IEEE. This was the chair of the policy group. He came up, worked with us, and he's had extensive knowledge and experience. In fact, he was here 2 or 3 years ago in Kenya, and he did 2 projects on off the grid power system. And I'm happy to connect you with Butch. It's amazing what it cost 3 years ago. It's about 3 times the price of what it cost us to do this system. And it has virtually the same specs. Okay, again, we went through the fundamentals, first of all, so that everybody understood what the power load needs were for the system. This is what Canada looks like in April. You probably can't identify with this. We go through 6 months of winter. This is what the greenhouse looks like before we start planting. We don't have a 365-day greenhouse because we are not pumping heat into the location. So I try to have, in fact, I could, with good a double insulation on the greenhouse, this is a 52 by 72 foot greenhouse. I could produce a lot of food in this between February and November. Problem is, from late November to April, it's really questionable in terms of the nighttime temperature. Okay, so we did the analysis and we looked at climate control issues, we looked at lighting, we looked at water and irrigation issues, and we looked at how can we have community engagement. So the requirements in the study was energy load calculations. We needed to look at what the battery losses would be in the system. We needed to have accurate calculations of the hours, the water requirements in terms of food production, obviously aesthetics, and the other thing that we really didn't think about and we didn't implement until it was after the fact was security, whether it be cameras or lock systems, and then, as I said, community development. So the breakdown, we looked at the fans and exhaust system for the earth energy system, flood lighting and LED lighting, which is very cost effective, and the pumps for pumping that water at 150 feet to the greenhouse. So this is what the students came up with. After they looked at the location, did the analysis, this was the design they came up with. 300 watt system. The earth energy system, if you're 15 feet down in the ground in Canada, even though that could be 20 degrees Celsius, minus Celsius outside, the ground is still consistently 15 degrees Celsius. So the air is still quite warm, or 55 Fahrenheit. So you can still draw warm air into the greenhouse. So this was one of the concepts that the students had, is the earth energy system, and I'll show you pictures of it. The idea or expected outcome that the students had was a four-season greenhouse, increased food production, document everything we did in the renewable energy source, and come up with tangible solutions for water, temperature, and lighting control. So, okay, so we, as I stated, the irrigation required a pumping system 117 feet. It needed LED lighting within the, these are not grow lights, by the way. We needed muffin fans to be operated. This is a 24-volt system. A deer cam system and a mesh network that we wanted to set up so that information could be conveyed back to us on humidity and temperature. So energy loads, as I stated, was a 24-volt system. We needed an inverter. We wanted to have the inverter, cell phone charging station, and we wanted to set up the with TP-Link system versus Ubiquiti. We found that the TP-Link or Microtech was a more reasonable financial model for us to use. Okay, so the solar system itself, and I'll just, for those who don't, are not aware of it, a solar or PV system incorporates all these components. The solar panels generate power. The controller, the regulator ensures that the most efficient operation of the panels prevents damage to the batteries, and the battery stores and collects the energy. Inverters convert the stored energy from DC to AC. So that's a fundamental system. So the pictures, in fact, Carlos, you sent all these slides different, right? Okay, well, you'll have all these slides. So there's a paper that goes with this that's much more in depth. And then there is a spreadsheet, which is a quantity takeout of every single item and where you can buy the stuff and pricing. So this is what the first step we did is we had access, rather than volunteers, when it came to the implementation, all those students, remember the picture I showed you a few minutes ago?
Yes.
They were nowhere to be seen when it came to building. It's amazing. So myself and my friends, you can see here, we actually built the system itself. It because of the latitude at 43 degrees, we really didn't have to put it on a frame like this, but aesthetically and security-wise, instead of something running over them, we built a frame system. And what Butch is on the lower left is actually working with the controller. And then next to the controller is our fuse panel. So this is a layout of the system itself. And again, we went with 8 solar panels. We needed cable controllers, connectors to connect the wires. They never showed up. I ordered them through Amazon. They never showed up, so we had to gerrymander all of these because that's what you have to have your plan B, because you can't rely on your suppliers delivering stuff on time, even though you have you ordered it well in advance. Batteries are expensive. These are really high quality batteries. They're 160 amp hours each, so we were using three batteries. Probably one of the most expensive elements in our system. We have our solar controller. I looked for an open source or a FreeBSD version of a solar controller. I couldn't find something, and there was price points. So this was merely $95. Then we also put in a series of diodes, Schottky diodes, and controller strips so that it wouldn't blow out any of the panels. Wire, inverter. And then you have to ground the system. If you don't ground the system, because again, lightning strikes could be an issue. I mentioned about the muffin fans or 0.5 amp muffin fans, and you'll see the picture of what I installed and how those fans operate. These are specs on it. The water pump, this was interesting. I looked at the specs of this water pump, and it looks like a fantastic pump. You know, I envisioned it would be so big, it would be able to pump 117 feet. When I got it, it was this large, just like the picture. So it was useless. So, and that's from a Chinese supplier. So you have to, again, expect that you won't get your stuff in time. The water pump demands were 30 minutes a day. So this whole concept of pumping water from 117 feet, I scrapped that idea. I put the water tanks, the 1,000-liter water tanks recently, in the last week or so, right next to the greenhouse, and I'm using just standard. floodlights, security cameras. So again, you need to really, our step-by-step process is when we analyze this project, you have to obtain your funding, and that was part of your community of interest, that the students were involved in the process as well. Step one, after designing the concept, is to go look for the money, obtain the materials, modify the quantity takeoff, because you can't get the materials you expected, as you expect 6 months ago, and organize the volunteers. The reality is, when it comes to engineers going out and getting money, that didn't work. It ended up being my responsibility, and we were able to secure the funding for it and be able to build the system. Let me move ahead quickly through this. All of this stuff, this slideshow you'll have. The greenhouse controls. This is Josh is one of my volunteers who involved with Mesh Toronto, and we set up a Raspberry Pi. I have some great pictures. We're getting some really good data coming out this for the drip irrigation system, and we're at the present time all the data we're collecting is onto an SD card off the Raspberry Pi. We have a step down from the 24 volt system down to 5 volt system, and I will send you the data and information. Eventually, when we get our mesh network set up, we won't have to put the data on SD cards. So the monitoring is done by the system itself, and it's using a SQLite database system. That's a quick picture of what the controls look like. So let me talk to you very quickly, wrapping up on the Wi-Fi system. The goal was to have telemetry information on humidity and temperature to get back to us, so that we can actually adjust the system to have proper irrigation and temperature controls. And so when we set it up, we on the bottom circle is where our garden is, 8 kilometers basically northeast is the highest point of land to something, to a repeater site. We had permission to put our TV link, the CP150 up on that, as well as on our tower on our site. And the TV link is good to 15 kilometers point to point system, 5 gigahertz, 300 megabyte system, and an excellent system. When we did the testing on site, we were able to transfer files back and forth. It only draws 11 watts. So with your power system, with your solar system, you have ample power to power the system. So we put the 20-foot mast at the garden itself, and we plugged it into the inverter, so that's why we had power. And then we went straight up, and that's sort of the configuration, what it looks like. So the cost was fairly minimal, $260 for the system. And we worked with the amateur radio, or ham radio organization, for this, because ham radio is obligated, like most of us, believe in the concept, they cannot make money from doing this procedure of providing emergency amateur radio. So we're very happy to come up with a mesh network that worked, because when they do emergency service, they're really, when there's a hurricane or some emergency in the United States or Canada and around the world, these are the people that actually provide regular communication. So they were very interested in working with us and their membership to come up with a workable mesh network. The Earth Energy, very quickly, that just shows the 15-foot deep trench that we dug and put the piping in. You can see there's some pictures of it we had to fill, and the look, it's hard to see from back there, but you see the series of pipes where we have air being pushed from the inside out, going into the ground, and we reverse the system when the temperature is later in the year. I'll skip all the details on costing on that, and the cost-benefit analysis. So where are we at with the mesh network? When we set the system up, there was a bit of a dip. successfully communicate to the tower. So what we're doing is, when I get back, we have on order four TV link devices, and we've gone out to the community to farmers that are north and northeast. So we're going to go up, then across, then over to the repeater. We have to go around this patch of trees that are blocking us. So as soon as that happens, I'll be updating this slideshow to share with you. So I'd like to acknowledge IEEE Power and Energy Society and all of you who are, okay. Anybody here an IEEE member? Okay. Anybody here on a member of their chapter, their IEEE local chapter? Okay. Please contact the Power and Energy Society. They have funds. IEEE Smart Village has funds. Humanitarian Activities Committee has funds. And I'll be at the Global Humanitarian Technology Conference in October. I'll be happy to share with any of you any of the papers. But if any of you are going, please submit a paper. This is a track. This humanitarian technology track is of really great interest to the community. Okay, I think that's it. Great, thank you.